So let's take a little bit closer look at rods and cones. They have a certain similar structure. They have this, we'll call it an outer part, but remember, the pigment epithelium is up here and the light comes in that way. But this is called the outer part because it's this inverted retina thing, right? And this inverted part is where you have these disc-shaped elements that react to light, and they react to different wavelengths of light. We'll talk about the different wavelengths in a minute. And those wavelengths and those reactions set up chemical reactions in the cell. And of course, it is still a cell, so it's got these inner elements, these organelles, and a cell nucleus. And then what's important is it has this synaptic body where it changes the chemical properties at the synapses depending upon the light. So let's take a look just at the rod for a minute. The rod has this chemical, these discs called made out of what's called rhodopsin, all right? And here you can act, this is an electron micrograph of what actually looks like. And this outer segment is made up of these plates, the rhodopsin plates. And what happens is that the rhodopsin is a chemical that when it gets hit by photons, it splits into two chemicals. I don't remember both their names. One of them actually is associated with vitamin A. Remember your mother always told you you had to eat your carrots in order to see well? Where does that come from? Well, the vitamin A in the carrots is involved in the chemical that's involved in rods being able to see light. So I'm presuming that that's why your mother told you that. Just ask her, all right? To stress the sort of chemical nature of what's going on, there's a slide here that just shows the same rod. And there's a sort of this change in these sodium ions. And I wrote it down in notes that when the rhodopsin splits, one part's called opsin and the other part is this vitamin A bit. And when light comes in, this change is sometimes referred to as bleaching the rods, right? So they start to change more. And how bleached they are is sort of how adapted they are, right? So when they're not bleached at all, a very small amount of light now coming in will change it. After you've bleached them a bit, now you need a different, you're now operating at a different light level. In fact, there were studies that were done that were showing that a single photon, so those of you who are familiar with the physics of light, a single photon can make a change in the cell that this system can detect, which is just remarkable, right? The ability of the system to detect small changes of illumination. And you can sort of ignore this diagram over here. It's just showing you that it's understood at a pretty detailed level how the light makes a change in the chemistry, and that the chemistry then changes what goes on in these synapses. Now, we said before that each of these photodetectors respond differentially to wavelengths of light. We showed you short, medium, and long. The one we didn't show you before was the one that includes rhodopsin. All right, so here's the blue or the short pigment, the green and the red, which we've looked at before. And here is what the rod responds to. And you see the rod is relatively broad spectrum. Okay, which is good because it means that if there's any of this kind of wavelengths of light coming in at night, the rods will be able to see them even though they have a very, very low amount of illumination that they're sensitive to. We're not going to talk more about cones and the tri-stimulus theory of color because we did that last time, but these are the four operating spectral responses that each of the photodetectors give you.